When it comes to learning to tune EFI, it can be a challenging industry to break into, particularly if you want to make it as a professional engine tuner. We're here with Devin from Boostin Performance, who is no stranger to high performance engine management systems. In particular, Devin's well known for their Red Demon, which currently holds the Mitsubishi four-wheel drive drag racing world record with a 704 at 204 mile an hour. More impressively, it's also gone as quick as 215 mile an hour in the quarter. Now, Devin, before you ever got to a point of tuning 7-second flat four-cylinder engines, you obviously had to cut your teeth on something a little bit simpler. I want to delve back into your background a little bit. How did you start learning how to tune engines?
Well, it started, you know, with my first car when I was 16. It was an 89 Dodge Daytona Shelby. And back then, you know, we had some really primitive ways of tuning. You had like a map sensor clamp. And we had fuel pressure and some bigger injectors, and that's basically where I got started.
But before you got into that, do you have a background in mechanics, or is this just a hobby for you at this point?
Well, at this point, it was just a hobby. You know, my dad always did all the work on his own cars in the garage, and I was always there with him. And then once I got my own vehicle and started modifying it, I figured out that I really, really love this stuff.
Now, it is quite difficult, particularly back then when access to information on the internet wasn't quite so prevalent. It's quite difficult to find out information about what to do. So how did you go about figuring out about these map clamps and things?
Sure. Well, there was a local group, SDAC, which is like a Shelby Dodge club. And we would all go to the track and meet up and basically share ideas there. And, you know, just when one guy would do it, it would work. Kind of, we would all do it. So.
And moving on from there, you obviously got a little bit more involved in the industry. Sort of, how did it go from a bit of a hobby to something that you've turned into a profession and a successful workshop?
Well, it didn't happen quickly. You know, we got a DSM, our 95 Talon that we're kind of known for, the red car. And we used to do a lot of street racing with the car, and we had a lot of success doing that. And people saw that, and my friends started asking me to tune their cars, and from there, it just, you know, I had more and more people ask me to tune their cars, and I thought about it and said, hey, you know, maybe this is something I can actually do. And that's kind of how that got started.
So at this stage, you're just 100% self-taught, and you're just doing this by trial and error?
Yep. Yeah, I didn't work at a shop, or, you know, I wasn't working on, you know, these cars professionally. I had a whole separate full-time job that I was doing, and, you know, this was just a hobby, and that was it.
And were you using a dyno for your tuning, or is this purely out on the road as well?
On the street. We were on the street. We were risking it all, which, looking back at it, probably wasn't a good idea, but, I mean, we had to do what we had to do, you know?
I think the other thing that people these days are probably spoiled a little bit, back years ago, we didn't have access to the quality of, first of all, aftermarket ECUs we see now, but also, just as importantly, the tuning tools. Wideband air fuel ratio meters were incredibly expensive and quite rare. Knock equipment was unheard of. So you've seen some advances in the industry that have made our jobs easier?
Absolutely. I mean, the wideband is probably number one. I mean, back with the Dodge Daytona days, we would look at the narrow band voltage, you know, we would check spark plugs, we would do everything we could, but I mean, the advancements in technology is what is making these cars so fast. You know, it's not really the tuners, it is, but the technology is driving it, and it's just great to be a part of and great to see.
So at which point did you decide, no, this is for me, and decide to take the leap and actually open your shop?
I had a full-time job, like I said, doing something else. I was actually a karate instructor. And it was great, it was fun, and I started doing the car thing as a hobby on the side. And, you know, I'd get done working the 40 or 50 hour week, and then we'd go do the car thing for 10 or 20 hours a week. And then I got offered a full-time position and decided to take it.
So with that full-time position, did this give you then the opportunity to really advance your knowledge and your experience?
Yeah, the shop that I got the full-time position at specialized in EVOs and DSMs. And when I got there, I was kind of the person that was the most knowledgeable as far as tuning is concerned. So I was able to jump right into the tuning position, and that's really where it took off.
Now, moving forward to modern days with particularly the Red Demon, I mean, getting a car like that to run seven zeros at 200 plus mile an hour is challenging. And at this point, there's not a lot of people out there doing this, so you really are in uncharted territory. And what have you sort of seen as the biggest progression that's allowed you to go that fast?
The biggest progression, I would say there would be two big things in my book that allowed the industry to progress so fast. Recently, you know, especially in the past couple years, turbocharger technology and engine management technology. Both of those have just been leaps and bounds. I mean, 10 years ago, you would say, you know, we're going to have 2,000 horsepower street cars that are driving around. You would say, no way. But I mean, it's a reality. We got one sitting right here. You know, so it's the turbochargers and it's the engine management systems.
Yeah, 100%. I would completely agree on both of those points. I think the turbochargers, what we've seen now is that, yes, you could get a turbocharger back 10 years ago maybe, that would support the kind of power that we're seeing. But the problem with it was that the response that you would see, you wouldn't be seeing full boost until you were basically right on the rev limiter. So we're seeing turbochargers that are now supporting massive amounts of airflow, but just as importantly, or maybe more importantly, they're also providing incredibly wide power ranges, so you can actually use all of that power. Now, in terms of the engine management advances, can you sort of delve into that in a little bit more detail and maybe let us know some of the specifics that you see have been so important?
Sure. I mean, well, if you talk about the Hall Tech and the Red Demon, you know, some of the stuff that we've integrated that would be newer to the industry is, you know, the flat shift, being able to use the strain gauge. We've got a race time rev limiter built into it in first gear to get the car to kind of, you know, calm the wheel speed down, boost by gear and time, you know, stuff like that. And with the Hall Tech, it's really nice because you can build a table with the X and the Y axis and you can just make it whatever you want. So if there's something you want to control that's not in the software, it's really easy to build it yourself and you don't have to call Hall Tech and get a bunch of support, which they do support very well. But, you know, being able to set up those tables myself and being able to achieve the goal without the assistance of somebody else makes it so much more seamless and so much more efficient for me, especially when I'm working on a customer's car.
Let's just jump back and unpack a couple of those things you've mentioned there. So first of all, the strain gauge, and I think this is really a key one. We've just talked about turbo technology, and the turbos have provided wider power bands, but ultimately, when you're making 1,800 horsepower out of Red Demon, so you know, you've still got a relatively narrow power band, and generally on the gear shift, if you have to use a clutch back off the throttle to change gear, you're going to find that turbo is going to drop back off boost, and it takes a long time to get back up on boost. So the strain gauge, can you talk us through how that system works and how it keeps that turbo on boost during the pass?
Sure. Well, with the Red Demon, we're basically right on the edge of making the power that we want, but with the response that we need. So basically what happens is we had the smaller turbos on there and the response was great. We wanted more power. We stepped up and we finally found the point to where the response isn't quite there that we need. So the strain gauge kind of gave us that response back. And basically what it allows us to do is when you pull the shifter, you basically preload it slightly, and then it cuts the ignition, allows the car to come out of gear and go into the next gear, and you're not closing the throttle plate, slowing the turbo down. It's basically just an ignition cut that allows the gear change to happen quick, efficient, and then the boost doesn't fall off because of it.
And important to note here, you can't do this with a conventional synchromesh style factory gearbox. This is something that can only be employed to a good effect on a dog engagement gearbox where you can shift without using the clutch, and this just allows you to stay at full throttle. Now, importantly here as well, on the Red Demon, you are still running an H-pattern gearbox as well, whereas we normally see strain gauges, not always, but normally they're applied to a sequential gearbox. So important to note here, you can use them on an H-pattern, it's just that it can only be used for detecting the upshift. It can't really distinguish between an upshift and a downshift. Is that reasonable to say?
Well, the strain gauge knows up and down. So I'm sure you can integrate it and do some downshifting. I know the road race guys do that. But as far as drag racing concerned, that's nothing that we're trying to do.
Okay, so a couple more things that you mentioned there. You were talking about the boost by gear and sure. Also timer-based boost. So again, launching a car off the line, you can't really launch with full power. You just end up going straight into wheel spin. So let us know how you're using that technology.
Yeah, I mean, we're using a 26-inch 8.5 tire, so we're limited on the amount of traction that we have. And basically the way you get the car to hook is just taper the power down a lot at the beginning of the pass and then ramp it in. So, you know, boost based on time and gear is what we use, and that allows us to basically hook the car, get it to ET the best it can, and then apply the power later down the track.
So can you tell us sort of in rough terms what boost pressure you're leaving the line with, and what are you seeing as you go across the finish line?
Sure. On the Red Demon, we leave roughly, it all depends on track conditions and a lot of different...
All depends on the conditions of the track and the car at the time. Yeah, everything obviously varies, but yeah, let's give us some rough numbers.
We leave the line at about 20 pounds of boost. First gear is about 40. Second gear, we target full boost, but it doesn't quite see it because of the load. And then third gear, 70 plus. Fourth gear on a good track, 80 plus.
That's a fairly large spread. Safe to say you're probably also using CO2 control to get that sort of spread?
Actually, we don't have to. With the precision turbo, the back pressure is low enough to where we can, gate pressure is 30 pounds, and it's only a 55% duty cycle at 80 plus. So, I mean, we haven't reached the limit of how much boost it's gonna make. We've kind of reached the limit of how much abuse our parts can take.
There's always got to be some limit in there. The last thing that you mentioned there that I wanted to dive into was your timer-based RPM through first gear. So let us know how that works.
Well, instead of you releasing the clutch and having just one rev limiter, which would be great for burnouts, but this allows you to, on a time-based scale, adjust your rev limiter. So you let the clutch out, and you have the rev limiter maybe just above your launch control and hold it for a while. And then based on time, you just slowly ramp it up to your main rev limiter, and it basically controls the wheel speed of the car out of first gear.
So basically just preventing that car going straight up onto the main engine rev limiter as soon as you leave the line and just sitting there wheel spinning. Exactly. Where do you see the end goal with the Red Demon in particular? How fast can you actually see that car going?
My end goal with the car used to be a bottom 7 second pass until we went 7-0. So, I mean, we've got to try and go sixes with it. That was the goal here in Texas. I injured my hand, wasn't able to drive the car, so we had to change those plans. But we will be back, and we will be shooting for a 6 second pass.
And unfortunately, there is the problem with drag racing that as soon as you eclipse one goal, there's always another. But right now, you're sitting right on that bubble, being the first into the sixes, and it's hard to see how you're not going to manage that in the fairly near future. And once you've got that 6 second pass, being the first, I think that's probably a pretty good achievement in itself. If you retired the car, then probably be no disrespect from anyone. Look. On the horizon in terms of what you see in terms of other advances that are coming out with ECUs that are going to help us as tuners, what do you sort of see there that could be coming up that's going to be beneficial?
I think what I have been seeing is basically faster processing speeds. So you demand something of the ECU and it doesn't take so long for the ECU to do it, or it could do it more efficiently, it could do it more precisely. So processing speed, along with obviously building the software that supports that, but especially with the MoTeC, I see that a lot, versus tuning it on a stock ECU versus the MoTeC. I mean, the processing speed is unbelievable. The amount of corrections that it can make in a split second is, with these cars, how they're going so fast.
Yeah, I think that's something that often is overlooked, and a lot of people think that any ECU is essentially going to deliver the same amount of fuel and the same ignition timing, so we're going to see the same power. And to a degree, under steady state conditions, that's absolutely correct. But of course, we're not operating under steady state conditions. It's very dynamic, and we've got some of these engines that can change engine RPM massive amount of RPM in a very short space of time. So the ability for that ECU to recalculate on the fly and maybe adjust the ignition timing so it's absolutely correct and the fueling does make such a difference to the consistency of the way the engine runs. Look, Devin, it's been really interesting to get some insight into your history, how you got to be a tuner, and also a little bit of history into Red Demon, a car that I've been personally following for a fair while now. We look forward to seeing you make that dive into the sixes. And if someone wants to find out more about Boostin Performance, how can they reach out?
Well, we're on boostinperformance.com, Boostin Performance on Facebook and Instagram.
Great. Thanks for the chat there, Devin, and good luck for the rest of the weekend.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
If you like that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up. And if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson.